Good evening, everybody. It's wonderful to see you. And today, we are here to explore the depths of our minds. I mean, that's what you know about this talk tonight. But the news is that what you need for this exploration is not some thought. What you need is the first two lines of this sign when you enter this facility where we are today. It says, present moment, wonderful moment. Present moment is exactly what you need. And if you handle that right, it can become wonderful moment. But by default, it isn't. You have to do something for it. When your mind is wonderful, your moment is wonderful. When your mind is afflicted and frustrated and terrible, then your moment is afflicted, frustrated, and terrible. So we start with the present moment. Zen means attain this moment 100%. If you attain this moment 100%, you attain your mind 100%. Why? What's the relationship? All your mind, everything you have in your conscious or subconscious self is projected into this moment. We call that presence, your own presence. So, if someone comes into the room and you feel, something's not right, then you may not have such a wonderful karma with that person. In Korean, we call that yin-yang or yin and yang. That means that your interaction with that person may not be so harmonious. And you feel that from the moment someone came through that door. How can you change that? If your clarity is stronger than someone else's disturbance, then you can be stronger without a fight. Most of the time, we want to win for three basic reasons. And one is possession, the other is procreation, and the third is survival. These are the three basic instinct groups that we have, very strong motivating forces. The kind of victory I'm talking about is not based on these instincts. It's based on a mind which is free from any idea of ego or self. And to attain this, we need to examine what we think we are and what we truly are. If you just sit down and look inside, you'll find many, many things in your mind. Thoughts, feelings, perceptions, impulses, and various forms of consciousness. Where do all these come from? Where do they come from and where do they go? Presently, we know that we use about 5-10% of our consciousness as a conscious entity. The rest is subconscious. And conventionally, we call this 5-10% I, and the rest we don't know about or do not want to know about. But from this line of me and not me, you can get many, many kinds of messages. And we call that intuitive surfacing. Something flashes in from your past, something from the present, something from the future. And you get these impulses from a place that you don't even see. And for that, you do not even have to reach down too much. You just have to stay in this moment, in this present moment, and try to keep this moment clear. And then you see everything. So for this journey, the exploration of the depth of your mind, you do not have to go anywhere. The more you try to stay here, the more journeys your mind wants to take. And you do not have to take these trips, but you can see where this would go. Your mind shows you a map where it would take you. And if you have some practice experience, you come back to this moment after the first couple of steps. We call that returning to the moment. Then the depth of your mind comes to you. In meditation, we have several methods. And what I want to talk about now is the question that like a drill goes through this line of me and not me. And this question is very simple. It goes like this. What is this? This question has history. Everybody knows in this room the name of Hui Neng, the sixth patriarch in China. And when he got transmission from the fifth patriarch, he had to escape. Even at that time, there were many ambitious monks, and some of them really did not tolerate the fact that somebody so young and relatively inexperienced, as it seemed, would get transmission. And that was a big deal. So a former soldier called He Myung, in Korean, was pursuing him. And soldiers are pretty good at tracking and search and pursuit. So Haemyeong found Huineng after a day or two. And of course, Huineng saw what was coming, so he was hiding behind a rock. And when Haemyeong reached nearby, he said, "Younger brother, please come out. I will not hurt you." And of course, before hiding, Huineng put the relics of the Buddha, the robe and the bowl, onto a rock. Formerly, if anybody possessed these two objects, that was the sign of true Dharma transmission to him. So when Haemyeong saw that, he just couldn't move them, and he said, "Younger brother, I didn't come here for the robe or the bowl, I came here for the true Dharma." When Huineng heard that, he had some faith, and he came out, and he says, "What would you like?" Then Haemyeong asked, "When the fifth patriarch gave you transmission, what did he teach you?" Then Huineng said, "When you don't think of good and bad, what is your true face?" And Haemyeong was shocked and got enlightenment. That's the story which is relevant to this question, because if you shorten the question, "When you don't think of good and bad, what is your true face?" then it essentially gets reduced to "What is this?" So true face means your true nature, your true self. So what is this that looks through your eyes, hears with your ears, moves your body, and says, "I"? What's that? To find that, sometimes you have to take a long journey. And that means you stay here at this moment more and more and more. And that's how the journey is going on. And the sentence by Huineng gives you a very important tool, like a method. If you keep a dualistic mind, which is divided into good and bad, right and wrong, like and dislike, me and not me, then you cannot perceive your true face. Because that's the kind of dualistic mind which keeps your small 5-10% from seeing your 90-95%. So what is important that you make this border, you make this line very transparent. Don't remove it, just make it very transparent. So that what you do with your consciousness would happily go into your subconscious, stay there, and after it gets ripe, the right moment, it comes back to your consciousness. The biggest problem is when you try to hinder it either way, then we have what we call personality disorder. You went through that a little bit or a lot, depending on your karma. Everybody's an adult here. Basically, this phenomena is going into two groups. One is you don't get what you want and you're looking for it. The other is you get what you don't want. So look at your own thoughts, look at your own feelings. Sometimes, "I really want to love somebody, but it's not there. It's not there. Why?" Then you realize it's not how it works. You cannot just flip a button and these emotions appear. It's not like that. Also, when you are really frustrated and you get some things you don't want and you don't like, you cannot just hate it and expect that it would go away. And if you lived long enough, you know, these attachments, whether it's attraction or repulsive reaction, they don't work. They don't work to the necessary extent. So this thing, journey to the depth of your mind, is actually a trick, because you don't have to go anywhere. What you need to know, what you need to see, what you need to experience will come up through this border, this gateway, if you let that happen. This gate is called the gate of not knowing or don't know. When you think, your mind moves. When you have dualistic thinking, your judgment distinguishes, even discriminates between you and the rest of the world. If you go deep enough, you can see how your mind redefines you as a separate entity from the rest of the world. This is like a very high frequency wave. It's not like that solid door, that within, that's you. Outside is the world. That's what we believe first, but it's not true. That door is a material illusion at 24 frames a second. That's why it appears to be solid. But if you stop the movie, the door disappears. So this frequency in your mind, this thinking, if you stop this thought, if you stop and you don't move, it disappears. In some very interesting science fiction movies, when people are put into jail, then there's just a beam of light, a laser beam separating them from the outside world, not a door. It's not solid matter, it's just a laser beam, but it does the same job. You can't go across because you burn. So this very strong division between yourself and your subconscious is acting in the same way. It defends and protects your notion of self. When you remove the energy from that and you don't make that anymore, the door opens, the laser beam disappears, and you're free. That means the world and you become one. And you experience your true nature, which is like infinite time and infinite space. I know that there are places and people that can actually take you for a mind trip. But anything that appears and disappears and moves from point A to point B, that's not what we are interested in. What is it that sees appearance and disappearance? What is it that perceives the movement from point A to point B? What's that? That's what's important, because ultimately that's what goes beyond life and death. From our personal point of view, our biggest appearance is being born, and the biggest disappearance is when we die. But what is it that perceives that? What is that? That is something you can only attain at this moment. No other time, no other place. That's why taking a trip in your subconscious, or in your past, or in your future, will not help you do that. It gives you something spectacular, but nothing else. And when you train and meditate, there are very interesting side effects. Your mind becomes more simple and more clear without losing any necessary qualities. Next, your intuition will get stronger. Your willpower will be more even. Most of the time when we are motivated, our willpower is like a burst. Bam! I want this! Let's do this! Let's get this! When you're not motivated, gone. When your mind becomes more even and clearer, then you can see it very, very clearly whether you need to do this, it's necessary or not. Whether it's yourself or another person, it won't matter. So willpower will serve you more evenly, because there will be no big ups and downs. And intuition in Zen is trained and developed by Kongan practice. That's when the dance begins. That's when you go to the uncharted territory that you have inside. And your first reaction to the Kongan that you cannot solve, of course, is frustration. I will kill this guy! How many times did you want to quit during a 3-day retreat? So you can see totally unforeseen reactions from yourself just because you cannot answer the question, why did Bodhidharma go to China? And then you ask yourself, how can I possibly react to this question like that? That's when your solid notion of self is kind of getting a little bit fuzzy and hazy. And there is a moment when you admit that you don't know. You really don't know. You don't know how to solve the question. You don't know the conditions how to solve it. You don't even know yourself anymore so much. And when this don't know appears, your gateway appears. That's when your mind actually starts to be rid of your ego, and then it can expand and become clear like space, clear like a mirror. And eventually, you will not only get used to this don't know, you will treasure it. It stops being this little frustration. It becomes the tool for attaining clarity. So ultimately, our job is right here, right now. And that's when the present moment can become a wonderful moment, if you have that mind. So what kind of mind do you have now? Interested? Disappointed? Little bit detached? Or very, very interested? Look inside. And if you find any questions inside, feel free to ask.
Okay, so you mentioned at some point that the point when you get to the moment when you say, I don't know, you have the gateway, or it starts to open, right?
Exactly.
So do you have to stay like that with the don't know part, or does it change into something else?
Yes, stay with it, but don't attach to it. Not even peaceful, not even calm. It's even before that.
Okay.
If you reflect, your mind moved and made peaceful and made calm. And then your mind moves, and then peace and calmness appears, disappears. Dono mind is clear like space, clear like a mirror. Only this moment, 100%. Very simple. So this Dono reflects. Your correct situation appears. Your true relationships all appear. And your necessary action and speech also appear. So this Dono is not like... We call that small Dono. Zen means big Dono. Big Dono is very good. It does everything. But if you're attached to anything in the mind, anything that arises, you can't get it. You know this Sufi tale from the Thousand Nights, Aladdin and the Magic Lamp. Look at it from this Zen point of view. Aladdin is looking for something truly essential and magical. And he finally opens the gate of the cave and he has to go inside. He has only one instruction. He cannot touch anything in the cave because if he does, he turns into stone. He should look for this really simple and seemingly uninteresting copper lamp and bring that out. And when he brings that out of the cave in broad daylight, and he has to a little bit rub it with some sand, and then the genie appears and say, "My master, what can I do for you?" And this was hundreds of years before Alice in Wonderland. So look at that. You open this gate of your own subconscious and you go deep, deep, deep inside. You touch any of your previous karma or unseen archetypes, anything inside, then your identity freezes. You turn into stone. But beneath all this, in the very depth of this cave, you find something which is really not eventful, not interesting, and compared to all your wonderful notions, it's totally just blank, too simple. You have to bring that up to the surface. That means you have to make that experience conscious. That's why you have to bring the lamp out of the cave to daylight. And rubbing the lamp means that it gets into contact with the outside world. Then the true qualities of your mind, your true nature, they all appear. And of course, you can read many interpretations of this tale, but what is most important, generically, essentially, that the impossible becomes possible. So that's why in your cave, in your being, if you touch any of your anger, desire, or dualistic, ignorant views, you turn into stone. You can't move. And many times you can see people, even very smart people, or intelligent, creative, talented people who are so much tied and bound by their own identity that they cannot move on the path, not even one step. They are going in circles all the time, reasserting themselves that they are always right. And turning into stone in this case is really significantly characterized by this sentence, "I am right, you are wrong." More questions?
You were talking about this world where it's not really relevant whether it's good or bad or things like that, but that's really related to meditation or just like everyday life? Or
which one do you want?
No, I'm thinking if it's everyday life, I mean, if you take society as a whole, how does it work out if there is no good or bad?
Originally, none of that. What you make is what you have. You make good, you have good. You make bad, you have bad. The most wonderful process is to see how this consciousness creates right and wrong, good and bad. It's awesome. It's super fast. And once you have a hold of that, then you can see the world as it is. But you have to start with yourself. We call this quality just like this, or in Sanskrit, tathata. The translation in English is suchness, thusness, or just like this quality. That's awesome, because when you have that, then you see really the stick as a stick, the sky as a sky, and the human beings around you just as they are, without the interference of your dualistic mind. So which one do you want? That's what will happen. This process of making dualities is so fast that only when you wake up from it, you realize that it happened. Just like a dream. You don't remember when you started dreaming, but you remember when you woke up. More questions?
It's a somewhat of a childish question. You are talking about that solid door, and you're also talking about the way, if I understood correctly, in which you can remove that door through meditation. Is it that physically possible?
Let's try it with the mind first. We don't teach kind of rough magic. Rough magic means that you want to control the material world. That's not what we teach. You control yourself with the right tool. So that is the magic inside. You remove your ego. And your ego has these hindrances, these identifications. But they're not solid. They are made by thinking, emotions, impulses, etc. And these move. They have a frequency. They appear and disappear. So when you don't move, that means you don't know, then this vibration disappears, like that. When you hear this sound, there is no thinking. Your reaction is not it. Before you reacted, that was it, okay? But it's a split of a second. So your karma is strong. Everybody's karma reconstitutes itself the second after this hit was heard. And meditation's job is to make this moment a little bit wider, stronger, clearer, so that your mind would lose the habit of reinforcing and reconstituting yourself, your own notion of ego. And that's how the door disappears. Yeah, your question is childish, but it's a wonderful childish question. It's good. Why? As children, we start to play with toys at first, and we are totally oblivious of ourselves. We look at the toys first, then ourselves, many years later. Adulthood comes when we stop playing, and you have to look inside because of your frustrations, your traumas, your unsuccessful attempts, whatever. You have to look inside because you cannot play the game outside. That's when you have to find your own gate. That's when you have to go deeper into yourself. That's when you have to know yourself better than before. That's when you have to ask yourself, do I want to live with the consequences of my actions, speech, thoughts, and emotions? And you realize that you have no choice in that matter, because you do have to live with the consequences of all this. But you can change something. You can change the cause, but you cannot change the effect, unless the cause has changed. So that's when we become adults. That's when we start to change ourselves. And that's when, as the Buddha says, we start coming out of the burning house. He says, sentient beings are like children playing with their toys in a burning house, and they don't know about it. The first reflection of being an adult is that you notice the passage of time. Then you're sad because you cannot reverse it. Then the time comes when you wouldn't even want to reverse it, even if you could. That's when you notice impermanence, that the house is burning. More questions?
So I wanted to ask you, but to say something before. I reached a state, let's say, when I feel that nobody can give me any answers, and I don't want answers because everybody has its own experience. What I wanted to say is that I feel and I know that reality is like what you feel, like a sound, no commentaries about it. So, you know, you have to trust the sanghas and find refuge in them. But I don't feel that need to ask questions and to, I don't know something theoretically. Because reality is just reality and so on. And I wanted to ask you if it's a bad thing or a right thing.
It's neither good nor bad. But you have a job. You have to ask yourself, is this it? Have I attained full, complete, unexcelled enlightenment or not? And depending on your answer to that, you have to do something. If you say yes, then it's time for you to help other people. Because then you are in the position to do that. But if you say something is missing, then you have to somehow continue your productive relationship to your teacher, the teaching that you carry, and the sangha with whom you practice. And the teacher is very important here. And you didn't mention that at all. Only you know why, and I don't touch that. But when we talk about the three precious gems, then one of them is your teacher plus your relationship to the teacher. Smart people like all of us in the West, in this room, we believe we read the book, we learn the teaching, what good is the teacher? Why? Well, the teacher's job is not what you think. The teacher's job is first to test you and to actually start taking things away from your self-image and actually give you a hard time when necessary, when you are prepared for that. And remember, this is not personal. Nobody is offending you or nobody is walking into your room and make a mess there. It's not like that. But if you practice, you need to lose your opinions. And when we practice, sometimes our minds become really productive, prolific, and superbly projective. And then our opinions become stronger. The teacher's number one job is to take away these opinions and ideas and projections about yourself and the Dharma and the world. Gone. And next is to give you the tasks so that you would do the bodhisattva job of helping all sentient beings. And in that realm, we all have some homework. You may find yours too. More questions?
Yeah, I know what you mean and I understood completely. Well, a big problem in Romania is that we don't have a teacher, so you can get an intimate relationship with that teacher. You always depend on... I know that you can have a teacher over border, but it's not the same thing. It's a big problem for Romania, that's what I think. And I don't know if anyone can do something about it.
When you seek, you find. Yeah. When the student is ripe, the teacher appears. So don't give up the search. Seek for the inside teacher. Then outside teacher also appears. But if you don't digest your understanding and you don't process your knowledge, it will never become wisdom. And your teacher helps you do that. Any true teacher does. And the closeness or intimacy that you mention has only one important job, so that your emotions could become compassion. And then your idea of yourself is gone. It's like a snake looking back at the old skin and saying, it was a skin anyway, let's go. But while you have that, you say, oh, what a beautiful skin. I love the patterns. Can you see it? That's me. But snakes, other reptiles, they shed their skin. It's very natural. I wish human beings would be in such a situation that it would be so easy to cast off your ego and you say, well, that wasn't me anyway, let's go.
There are two questions. The first one, he's asking for three simple pieces of advice for someone who doesn't practice Zen, but has to work for 8 hours a day, and work being 80% of the conscious state during the day.
80% of what?
The conscious state. And he wants to know three pieces of advice you can give him, how to integrate Zen into that work period.
Number two.
How could we understand the absence of good and bad?
Number three.
Simultaneous with the idea of karma. It takes into account good and bad karma.
Okay, and after that, we have a second question as well. Is that correct? You are a rich man. You have wonderful thoughts, many of them. Let me ask you, did you produce this in the 80% or in the 20% of your mind?
He didn't understand the question.
Good. That's how you begin to integrate your daily life into Zen and vice versa. Do not make 80% 20%. Do not think of strict 8 hours. Do not limit yourself. That's number one. Just find some time in the morning and in the evening to practice some meditation. That's all you need to do. But when you set up these limitations, even if it's observation, don't attach to that. Because then these limits will actually tie and bind your potential. Keep it simple. Practice in the morning, practice in the evening, and then if you do this for a long time, then those 8 hours during the day will transform into a meditation method, not a burden. So your work becomes meditation. But to attain that, you have to practice and also formally. If you have this mind, then there will be no wasted time. And that's very important. If you think that your work is sometimes boring, takes 80% of all your energy, etc., etc., in your mind, you already wasted it. Don't. So how do you keep your mind right now? How do you keep your mind during your work time? So observe every moment as if it was fresh and new. In Zen, we call this beginner's mind. This beginner's mind is very precious. It gives you new potential, new possibilities. Even if you have to drive a van or a car all day, your driving experience will become totally different if you merge that with Zen meditation. So practice, become one, and use the moment. More questions?
You talked about enlightenment, and she was wondering if you had attained it.
I'm wondering how you would understand my reply. First of all, you understand English, and that's good. But you can also speak English. Zen Master Lin Chi said, even uttering the word enlightenment is like pouring a bucket of shit over your head. So when I did that, I poured the bucket of shit over my head and you pick up the pieces. It's not so good. What do you see now? What do you hear now? What are you doing right now? What kind of mind do you have right now? That perception, this moment, that's important. You put a word over it, you kill it. So don't make enlightenment, please, just practice. So one day, somebody saw a very beautiful snake and wanted to help the snake. So grab the snake and put some legs on it that it could go a little faster because just on the ground, you know, it's kind of tedious. But more legs? And the snake could walk, even run. And his friend saw it and says, oh, not only that, I mean, these legs, they shouldn't get cold, so why don't we put some socks over them? Then the third guy says, uh-oh, what if it rains? Let's put some shoes over it. Then soon the snake died. And these people were wondering, where did we go wrong? That's why they said, if you meet Buddha, kill Buddha. And that wasn't instigating murder. And fortunately, nobody takes that, you know, personally. So if you meet the devil, kill the devil. That's pretty easy. But the knife which kills Buddhas, demons, and all ideas is the same knife. And you return to this point. All ideas disappear, including enlightenment. Okay?
A small question. The ego that has to do the change, I don't know to what, everything, it's also the ego that needs to be changed or to disappear. It seems like it's a sort of duality, but it's a paradoxical one, because of, you understood, right? The ego that, maybe it's because of me, that's what I'm saying. So the ego that needs to be changed, it's the ego that does the change. And
not quite.
Oh.
Paradoxes are great because it stops your thinking. But your ego alone cannot make that change happen. You need some added quality, what we call no I. And without that experience of no I, there is no change. Because what would it be that changes you? What would be that fundamental experience that prompts you for that change? And that's not your ego, that's something else. So if you do not experience this no I, the Buddha called it anatman or anatta. If you don't experience that, your notion of self cannot change because it's tied and bound by your own ideas, attachments, identifications, etc., etc., etc. How do you know, or how do you see, whether it's in yourself or someone else, that this change happened? How do you see that? That arrogance disappeared. and thoughts became the servants of something much higher. Selfish, possessive emotions like jealousy, fear, they all disappeared and compassion appeared, because that shows that you serve something much higher. That means you can selflessly help other people. What kind of mantra do you do? Yeah, something Tibetan, right?
Yeah.
Good. Keep doing that. It will process everything. Okay? More questions?
What means that the house is burning while we are playing? How would you explain this? How it means to feel it?
Do you know that you will die?
I know that I will die like everybody else.
That means you are still in the burning house. When you say like everybody else. No. You will die just like you do. Okay? So when you notice that you will die, you see that the house is burning. It's called impermanence. Before we actually admit that this life will end for us in its own way, and we don't involve anyone else, because when you die, you are alone. Even if you're in the richest 10,000 of the world and you're surrounded by a lot of people, you die alone, in your way, depending on your karma. When you notice that, you see that the house is burning. That's when you have a chance to come out.
Death is something that will come in time, or my death is right here, right now.
No, you are alive, I'm happy to report. Your mind is in your body, and you feel that. That means you're alive. But the notion of death, that this will stop one day, when it becomes reality for you, and it goes into your cells, not just in your thoughts, when it's in the marrow of your bones and you feel the clock ticking, that's when you see the burning house. And for the Buddha, this was when he turned 28. That's when he saw impermanence. That's when it hit him like a Mack truck, not just like a nice movie or a theater performance, and you can keep yourself out of it. You can detach from it. You think, well, maybe some other people, but not me. So how long do we entertain that notion? When we stop entertaining that notion and you feel that this body will die and your mind will depart and it's inevitable, that's when you are mature. That's when you see the burning house. And that's when your perception and perspective of life completely changes.
But just a quick short question regarding the metaphor he used, and you used actually before with the house on fire. You said you come out of the house on fire, but what do you come out to?
What do you see right now?
A few people and you're...
That's what your mind tells you. Do you see how you substitute thinking with visual data, visual perception? What is it that your eyes see and your visual consciousness interpret? That's not you and people. Forms and colors. Okay? What do you see?
Stick.
Yeah. Stick, we got to the form, finally, great. Can you mention a color or something like that?
Yeah, a brown
great.
Stick.
Great, so you have a brown stick in your hand, great. Or this thing behind is beige-ish with some stripes.
Not good with colors.
Whatever. Well, try. Yeah. Use your visual consciousness as long as you have it.
Yeah, of course.
So you come to this. When you get out of the burning house, you attain this moment. Before that, you're only burning with your own thoughts, feelings, perceptions, impulses, and consciousness. Avalokiteshvara called this the five skandhas, the five building blocks of your personality. And when that becomes empty for you, no more identification with that, then you are out of the burning house. And that's the recipe in the Heart Sutra. It says, no eyes, no ears, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mind, no realm of eyes, no realm of any mind consciousness. Well, that's coming out of the burning house.
So I'm actually not that I don't have a lot of experience in yoga, just to put it like that, and Zen for that matter either. But why do people turn to this? I mean, why do they come towards Zen or yoga or things like that in your experience or vision? Or
I can only tell you a few people I know very well, and that includes my own motivation. When we were in crisis, nothing else worked, only this. And if nothing else works, and this does, you stick with it.
I think, so I wasn't here from the beginning, and you maybe answer to this question, I don't know. And I want to ask you, what's the big advantage to get rid of your ego?
Well, if you don't see the problems of having one, how could I explain? There's a saying, if it ain't broken, don't fix it. So if you have no suffering, if you have no frustration, if you have no notion of anger and unfulfilled desire, then this whole thing is not necessary. Then have fun. So.
It's clear that I have those kind of problems.
Wonderful! Human being! Like all of us. That's great. Okay? So, once you have suffering, and it doesn't mean somebody's torturing you, just the general notion of being in this life, in this body, being impermanent, interdependent, and imperfect, that is plenty for our notion of suffering. And then you see the cause of suffering, the end of suffering, and the way to end suffering. And once you want to do this, you're on the path. So, look at yourself. Where does all this that you want to get rid of come from? Where does it come from? And you ask that question and there's something really unclear inside. There's something that you haven't explored, haven't visited, haven't seen. And that's when your practice begins and you inquire, where does all this come from? Why do I react to my mother like that? Etc. And then you see better, you perceive better, that what you thought you were is actually not true. You're different. And then you carry this on and on and on until you get to the point of don't know. That I actually don't know exactly who I am. And then your practice actually starts to progress very well. You know your name, you know your ID, you know your job. But all that became separate from your notion of identity. And that is wonderful. You see yourself as you are, but without the superimposition of I, my, me. And that's the chance that we have. We call that clear, non-dualistic mind. Okay? It works much better than these distortions. More questions?
So what is the role of the physical body in our spiritual evolution? Do we need complex postures or anything?
It's your primary vehicle and inanimate teacher. We spent pretty much 20-25 years clarifying our relationship to the body. What is mind? What is body? What's the function of each? It's a very big task. So taking this body when we are born means that this body becomes our teacher. And it has many other jobs, but from our point of view, these two are really important. Well, first, it becomes your inanimate teacher because this body itself is not alive. You are. So it teaches us just by the way it functions, and we have to clarify our relationship to it. And number two, this body is your vehicle to take you to a real teacher, a human teacher. Okay? By being born, we bring ourselves intentionally to a difficult situation. Why do we do that? We have plenty of motivation. One is what the Buddha calls tanha, or thirst. We are thirsty for seeing, hearing, tasting, smelling, touching, emotions, thoughts, speech, actions. It's our desire to be born. Without a body, how could you touch? Without a mind, how could you think? Without a mouth, how could you talk? So this primary thirst for the experience of the individual, of the self, of your willpower, of all the input and output that I mentioned, that is a primary motivating force to be born and suffer the consequences. And there is an equation, like in mathematics, but it's not difficult. To make karma, you have to be born. Because only when you have I, my, me, that's when you can make karma. And the other part is, if you want to take away karma, you also have to be born, get rid of your I, my, me, and clear the karma. So whatever we think of the afterlife, perhaps we can agree on one thing, we don't have a body there. Because that's how we entered that realm, that we died. So the bardo of not being born or having a discarnate state of mind implies a lot of things. One is that you cannot make or take away karma. And that's one primary reason why we want to be born again. So use your birth in the best possible way. If you were born just for yourself, soon you will experience all the shortcomings and misery and frustration of having an isolated self. But if you open this up and you were born for other people, to help them, to guide them, to relieve them from their suffering, now life opens up and it becomes totally different just throughout your own transformation as a human being. You can do that. You know what is the main underlying cause of being an addict? Any kind of addict, whether it's drugs, internet, sex, whatever you call it. Because at some point, that individual felt isolated, neglected, and did not receive enough love and compassion and help to open up this isolation and making it disappear. Because in this true love and selfless compassion, your ego, your notion of an isolated self against the world, against others, it disappears. And when you get disappointed and don't trust that anymore, you try to find other ways to burn this notion out, to burn out the notion of individuality. And the tragedy is that it becomes stronger and stronger and stronger, because the more interdependent we are, the more dependencies we build up, the more addicted we are, the stronger the isolation is. I had the fortune to teach recovering drug addicts meditation about 10 years ago. Physically, they were clean, and mentally, they already saw their own addiction and didn't follow it. But they knew that in the depth of their minds, they will be addicted for the rest of their lives, even if it doesn't appear anymore. And their primary concern was whether Zen meditation could give them a joy greater than drugs. And when I said that meditation gives you a different kind of joy than drugs, not comparable to that, they were disappointed. Because once they understood and attained that they cannot get high by some chemistry, they wanted to get high clean, just with their minds. So what is the ultimate trip? That doesn't cost you anything, that doesn't put you into prison and doesn't destroy you. That's the ultimate trip. And still gets you high. Then I told them, yeah, you can call it cold ecstasy, but Zen is not about that. And I said, the biggest transformation you can make, that you stop being focused on yourself and you focus on the other person more and try to help them. That's when true love and selfless, compassionate mind can appear and this isolation would be over. But they spent so much time within the wall that most of them did not believe that this would be possible and substitute that state of mind, the addicted and afflicted state of mind that actually made them so happy and miserable at the same time. Last few questions.
I have a bit of a more generic question. What does Zen meditation stand for more specifically? Better yet, is there any graspable difference between Kundalini meditation or Zen meditation, for instance, or any kind of meditation will do eventually?
Well,
if we practice it.
Yeah, there are technical differences between Zen and everything else, like yoga or other Mahayana schools, or for that matter, Theravada schools. These technical differences are too great to enumerate, but one thing which comes from Taoism and very important in Zen meditation, that you focus on your Muladhara chakra or Tantian, and you don't visualize, you don't shut your eyes, and you shut your eyes like halfway down, or you keep it a slit open, that inside space, outside space could become one. So meditation methods are different. Also, directions. why you meditate and how you meditate, they are also different. But if you practice a tradition correctly for 10 years, you will see that the only hindrance was you. So then you can practice any kind of technique once your walls are down. So in that sense, all of them can come to the same point of transforming you, giving you the attainment of your non-self or no mind. That's all possible. But since we have karma, we need to find a tradition we believe in, a technique we can use, a teacher we can trust, a sangha we can blend in. That's why it's important to have so many. This kind of versatility, multiplicity, adaptability, that's the key for not just the Dharma to survive, but to be relevant and adaptive in any human situation. So the essence of the path is not something that you can put into words or forms. So this point has no thinking, no appearance, no disappearance. So anything you say cognitively or put into an observable form is circumstantial. These circumstances, which are really imperfect and dependent on many, many conditions, can help you get to this point, which is beyond all appearance and disappearance and ultimately life and death. That's why trust and faith are very important. You don't trust the teacher, you don't have faith in the tradition, you cannot find harmony with the Sangha, you're wasting your time. When you buy a household appliance in the store, you know that it's not the user's manual that you have to read for years. It's the appliance that you want to use for years. But in terms of our Dharma studies, many times we read the user's manual for years and we don't switch it on. We don't interact. We don't do it. And if we do that, it's like an aircraft that it keeps taxiing around the airport but never goes off the tarmac to the runway, never full throttle and never takes off. And that's very sad. Because people believe in the aircraft that they are flying, but they never leave the ground. It's like you're thinking. You think you understand the Dharma, but you never experienced even one moment of no time, no space, no thought, no I. You never took off. So what kind of aircraft, what kind of pilot, doesn't matter. Fly. And don't crash. Whatever tradition, whatever teacher, whatever teaching, doesn't matter. Attain. Okay?
Yeah.
Good. You're welcome. Last question.
Can we find out in this moment what the karmic situation of a person is? If it's very good or very bad?
Let me ask you, why is your question general and not specific?
He is interested in finding out where is he in this present moment.
Now that's a little closer. Why do you want to find that out?
He wants to find out if he has a shorter path to walk or a longer path.
What kind of martial arts do you do?
Karate.
Very good. So I give you a karate story. Young master received authority to teach from the old master in traditional Japan. And everybody was super happy and they went to drink sake and have a party, etc., etc. Great martial art. And they got sufficiently drunk, but they could still walk and talk, and not only talk, but also kind of shout around a little bit. And as they were going back towards the dojo, they passed a horse cart. And this young master, no matter how much sake he drank, he perceived that due to their noisy and reckless behavior, the horses will go wild. So he suddenly leaps up into the air, lands before the horses, and hits the first horse that would go wild gently with his fist, and the horse wakes up and doesn't go wild.
Then
everybody said, "Oh! What a great master! Wonderful! He is the real article! Great, great, great!" So they run up to the old master, to the dojo, and tell him about this. Then the old master goes like this, "Oh, I made a mistake. I gave transmission too soon." Everybody was shocked. I mean, your student, the young master, was so great. Why do you say that? So young master hears about this and runs up to the old master. He's a sincere guy. He bows to him and says, "Sensei, where's my mistake?" Then sensei said, "If you perceived early that the horses would go wide, you should have gone around the horse cart, very big circle, and completely avoided." And to give you a little dessert, there's another story which is more direct, but you had to hear this first. A student wants to study the true path from the teacher. And he asks, "Master, I move into your temple. I serve you day and night. I practice as much as I can. I do all the work. How long will it take to get enlightenment?" Then the master says, "Well, 3, 5, 6 years, who knows?" But then the student says, "I will bow 1,000 times a day. I will chant mantra 6 hours a day. How long will it take?" Then he says, "Maybe 10, 15. I will give myself completely to the Dharma. Never lie down to sleep. Eat only 1 meal per day. How long will it take?" 20, 25. Then the student gets really desperate and says, "I will give my life for the Dharma. Completely die for it. Then how long will it take?" Then the master says, "Then I really don't know." Why did the master say that? That is my gift to you at the end of this Dharma talk. So I truly appreciate your good attention and wonderful questions, and hope to practice with you tomorrow and subsequently, so that we all attain our true nature and save all beings from suffering. Thank you very much.